So we're a small group today, and I actually like these forums best when they're groups of about this size. I think it's a little bit of Goldilocks syndrome. My partner John Chamberlain and I have been going, as was said, all around the valley. We're also doing a similar project in LA County, and all told, by the end of this week, we will have completed nearly 40 of these forums. And the best ones have been with groups of 30, 35 people. It's just the right fit. So I'm delighted that that's the size our groups turned out to be today. How many of you have been to a forum somewhere here in the valley in the last 4 to 6 weeks on one of these regional planning talks? Most of you have been here before and you came back. It's got to be the food, right? So here's the interesting thing. No pun intended, all of these sessions have a different flavor, and it's only Kern Inyomono Workforce Development Board, the employment training network here, that bribes attendees with food, and I say whatever it takes. So kudos to the board, and kudos to Subway, and I thank you all for being here. So I do this a little differently than my partner, John, in terms of starting out. So you guys all know John, right? So John Chamberlain. So he and I are working on this project together, and I like to size up our partnership like this. If you're of a certain age, you'll remember going to the record store as a kid, and you would go to buy a 45, and on that 45 was the record that you were going to buy, and with some enthusiasm, I'm sure you took it home and you put it on your record player and you played it. Well, as you may recall, there was a B-side. There was actually music on the other side. It wasn't anything you were interested in listening to, and it was something that you never played, but it was there. Well, that's what you can think of me and John. He is the A-side, the reason you went to the record store, and I'm the B-side. I mean, I'm fully functional. It does play. It's just that you don't really want to listen to it. So anyway, completely functional, and we'll get through this together. I'd like to start out talking a little bit about the regional plan that we're working on in the regional planning process. I think it's really helpful to kind of put our dialogue, which we're ready to engage in, into context. It is a bit curious to me, too, that when you walk in, they give you food, because this isn't really a listening, a session where I do the talking. It's a session where I'll talk for about 10 minutes, and then I'll turn it into a listening session, and you'll have a mouthful of food, and I'll say, would you like to speak? And it's kind of an awkward thing, but we'll get through it, right? So a little bit about regional planning. So as you probably know, Kern County, along with adjacent counties, and frankly, every community in the nation, receives federal workforce funding. And federal workforce programs are, without any debate, at least 40 years old, if not 60 or 70 years old. Probably the first iteration of federal workforce funding came during the FDR administration in the form of the Works Progress Administration, the WPA, and that was all about putting people to work, and we have to this day bridges and dams and highways and all sorts of things that were built under the WPA. But the workforce programs that we have today really were kind of born in the 70s under a program that went by the name of CETA, the Comprehensive Employment Training Act. Anybody remember CETA? That you kind of have to be of a certain age. So you're showing your age just a little bit if you remember CETA. And after CETA, we had the Job Training Partnership Act, followed by the Workforce Investment Act, and now for about the last year and a half, we've had the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. So one program after another, and they're all, like a professor of mine said in college one time, I remember, political science professor, he says, it's always like a new sausage, or an old sausage in a new skin. It's just the same thing over and over again. Well, that's not quite true, but it's somewhat true. Since about 1982, with the advent of our Federal Job Training Partnership Act, our workforce programs have been largely state administered or state overseen. And since that time, we've been required to write state plans and local plans, both of which described how we intended to use these federal resources to train people, connect them to jobs, and to meet the needs of business and industry in our communities. Well, with the advent of WIOA, our new program that we implemented, as I say, about a year and a half ago, there are new requirements around regionalism and they ask that governors, one of the things they ask with regard to regionalism, is that governors take a look at the landscape, not the literal landscape, but the economic landscape of their states, and see if there are discernible economic subregions in which we can organize workforce development activities. And here in California, the governor, probably not the governor himself, he's kind of busy, but the governor's staff did take a look, and they were able to define 14 subregions. And one of those regions goes by the very long name, San Joaquin Valley and Associated Counties Regional Planning Unit. And it consists of 8 workforce development boards here in the Central Valley. Represents 10 counties, because we have Kern and Inumono functioning as one board, and then there are 7 single county boards that comprise the San Joaquin Valley RPU, Regional Planning Unit. So we have this task before us now to develop a regional plan and to start thinking regionally. What does that really mean? I think it means in terms of this plan to identify opportunities to do what we do well locally across the region, to get more traction, to scale up our strategies in terms of business engagement, sector responsiveness, et cetera, to levels beyond the confines of a single county or a single area. The notion being, again, that if it has value in one place, it may have yet more value throughout the region. And so we're looking for opportunities to do this. So after John and I were hired by the Central Valley to do this process, we put our heads together around the notion of how are we going to get at information. One of the things that you have no lack of here in the Valley are reports. There seems to be a report on everything. You know, the use of water, the use of human resources, you know, the education, partnering with economic development and study and report and data and et cetera and so forth. So there's lots of stuff we've been able to read about your Valley. But we thought in looking at all of that, what we would be missing if we only read reports and only looked at studies, that we'd be missing human intelligence. The intelligence that you bring from the communities where you live and work, your experiences, your thoughts, your perceptions. So we began to dissect the topics in the regional plan that we were going to be asked to cover in the regional plan. And we were able to come up with 5 kind of broad topics which we wanted to take into the community and chat with you all about. And they are the following. One of them is career pathways. Another is industry valued credentials. And if that doesn't sound kiss of death boring, I don't know what does, but that actually is a very interesting session where we dialogue mostly with businesses about what value they place on the kinds of diplomas and degrees, et cetera, that we're delivering. We're actually doing a session of that type tomorrow morning in Modesto. If any of you are up for a long drive, we would be happy to have you attend. Another topic we're doing is pathways to the middle class. A fourth topic is system accessibility, which we're actually going to touch upon today during our discussion of workforce and education resources. And then finally, the fifth topic is workforce and education resources, to take a look at what's available throughout the Valley and quite simply to see if we can identify, based on what's working well, certain strategies that we might, again, scale up or scale out throughout the Valley and, you know, extract the DNA from what we're doing well and see if we can use that to develop, to expand, to broaden what we do regionally. So that's kind of the background for what we're looking to accomplish today. This is, once I'm done yammering at you, I'm trying to give you some opportunity to eat, so I'm giving you a few minutes here. Once I'm done yammering at you, it's really going to be about you talking. And we've got a very simple set of questions for you. There are actually only 4 questions that we're going to be posing to you today. Before we do, I have a couple other slides. The slideshow is very sophisticated. I think there are a total of 4. The purpose of regional planning under WIOA is really the development of regional sector pathway programs. And I bring that up because all three of those words are pretty important. Usually in any expression, there's at least one throwaway word. There isn't there. Regional sector pathway. And by regional, we mean pertaining to the region that we've defined for our workforce plan. That's the San Joaquin Valley. Everything really from Stockton down through Bakersfield, you know, and the counties that they're associated with. Sector pertaining to those industries which hold the greatest promise for economic growth and vitality here in the valley. So the this has just recently been discussed among the eight boards, but we are zeroing in on those industries that will be the focus of our regional plan. I think most of them will not surprise you. They're the usual suspects for the valley. They're advanced manufacturing, transportation and logistics, healthcare, to a lesser extent, construction, some hospitality and tourism, et cetera. So there will be highlighted within the plan those industries that are A, most prevalent, and B, hold the greatest promise for creating economic vitality for the valley and economic prosperity for people living in the valley. So that's the focus there. Pathway, meaning programs that prepare individuals to do a job or group of jobs, are programs too, as I said, because they are sectoral, are focused on demand industries, and we're really talking about our regional plan describing a demand-driven system. How education, those in economic development, workforce development professionals focus on creating programs, delivering services that prepare people for those jobs that are in greatest demand. And then finally, the last thing that you would see on the slide behind you, but you don't see because it's not there, but is on this page here, is that in terms of developing a demand-driven system, we're talking about a system that creates opportunities for all job seekers. I'm going to try this one more time while I'm doing this to bring this live. And when I say opportunities for job seekers, I'm talking about those who may have barriers to employment and other job seekers as well. I think it didn't like that one slide. Do you think that maybe is true? Okay, we'll see. Yep, that was it. It didn't like that third bullet. Okay. The third bullet says also ensure that everyone, including those with barriers to employment, have opportunity to develop skills required for jobs in demand sectors. Nothing scary about that, but PowerPoint didn't like that expression. So we'll work through that. So here's some background on this topic. I want to put workforce and education resources into context for you, so that when I give you some questions about it, you're going to be prepared to answer those questions. So my first bullet is to state the obvious. There are abundant resources. These regional plans are being done all over the country. They're being done in Fairbanks, Alaska. They're being done in Guam. They're being done in the northernmost counties of California. So if we were in Weed, anyone ever been to Weed, California? Okay, you've been to Weed. It's lovely, isn't it? There are weeds and trees and a person or two and cows and such. And so if we were up in Weed, we might be talking about resources, right? We might be talking about, are there enough programs available to train people? Here in Kern County, not so much. We know we have a state university, we have community colleges, we have an adult education system, K through 12, and lots of other resources. We'll talk about those more specifically in a minute. So when we talk about workforce and education resources, I want you to think initially about the types of skills training programs impart. For instance, foundational skills. There are certain training programs that you can go to and you can learn foundational skills. Anybody have any clue what I might be talking about here? I'm really talking initially anyway about literacy and numeracy skills, those computation, communication skills that form the basis for pretty much everything we do in the workplace. It is interesting, this is a little kind of teaser, you know, or maybe even you know, an alert that I'm going to give away the end of the story, but one of the things that we have been learning about foundational skills is Nowadays, they seem to include other skills besides just literacy and numeracy. Depending on where you go, tech skills might be considered a foundation skill, basic computer literacy skills. Depending, again, where you go and what industries you're talking about, customer service skills are sometimes described as a foundational skill. So think about these resources in terms of foundational skills. Think about them in terms of academic skills. Those programs, those organizations, schools, etc., that deliver academic skills, think about them in terms of job skills, programs, resources that teach the hard skills for welding, teach the hard skills for bookkeeping, teach the hard skills for information technology jobs, software skills, etc. So think of programs like that. And then finally, and this is maybe where the workforce system comes in more strongly than they do in the three preceding bullets, is think of soft skills, it should be plural, soft skills like work readiness and work maturity skills. The more and more I can tell you that John and I have talked with businesses throughout the Valley, the more emphasis we've heard placed on soft skills. Now, other people call soft skills by different names as well. Some people call them essential skills. I sometimes refer them to them as durable skills, but they are those skills that are come to life in the form of workplace behaviors and attitudes that businesses really value and absolutely insist upon in terms of timeliness, working as part of a team, critical thinking skills, etc. So when you think about these resources, all of these various resources, and we haven't named them yet, we're going to name them in just a minute, that impart foundational skills, academic skills, job skills, soft skills, think about them in terms of their value to business. Are these the skills that businesses really value? Which businesses? Well, particularly those businesses in the demand industries we spoke of earlier. Remember, we talked about ag and manufacturing, healthcare, logistics. Do businesses in those sectors value the skills that we're teaching? Think about too, and we're talking about programs that impart job skills or soft skills, etc. Think about their suitability for new workers, new entrants to the workforce. These could be young people. This could be people returning from the military who've never worked in a civilian workforce before. But also think about their usefulness for employed individuals, incumbent workers. So if somebody here owns a company or manages a business, one of the first things that we'll often hear from that individual is that he or she, yeah, they'd be interested in getting a pool of new workers, of new applicants who have skills, but they're equally interested, maybe more interested, in training, upskilling opportunities. If that's a Samsung 7, we're going to have to ask you to leave the room and throw it into the nearest dumpster. It's really funny. I put it under the podium. I carry a Samsung 7 Edge, but I fly a lot. I like turn it on the, you know, you're landing on the plane and they say, okay, you can turn your phones back on, blah, 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 you know, or come out of the airplane mode. But I usually turn mine off. I turn it on and the first thing that comes up on the screen is Samsung 7, and invariably somebody will shriek next to me, you know, because they think it's the exploding variety, and it's not. But, you know, I'll do anything for a little bit of attention, so I kind of like that. So think about the value for employed workers. And then finally, in terms of these resources, think about their overall strengths and weaknesses. Because today we're looking to see if we can identify some models of what are good programs, strong programs, programs that we might want to replicate. So that's all the background that I'm going to give you. We're going to dig right into the questions, which I know you have before you. They're in your handout. So Michael is going to be passing the mic around. And just so you know, so we're completely unambiguous, we understand one another, if no one volunteers to speak, I will volunteer you. So that's the trade-off for the free lunch. So let's go through the four questions, and then I'm going to ask them one at a time. So question number one, what education, training, and workforce resources does our community currently have? Question two, do these resources provide trainees the skills needed for in-demand jobs in key sectors? Well, we haven't defined in-demand jobs in key sectors, so I'm gonna let you do that as part of your response. Third question, how can we improve the ways in which these resources are used to help all job seekers, including youth and those with barriers to employment, succeed in the identified high priority career pathways? And we're going to talk about what you think the high priority career pathways are. Why did I include the term youth and those with barriers to employment? Because that comes right out of our state workforce plan. And then finally, how can we ensure that youth and job seekers with serious barriers to employment have access to and can succeed on these career pathways? A really important feature of our state workforce plan is that we make sure that as we are developing regional sector pathway programs, as we're designing strategies to train people for jobs and demand sectors, that we don't do so in a way that excludes certain populations. There is an inference, I'm gonna call it an inference, in the state plan because they don't exactly say this, but there's an inference there that we as a system, education, the colleges, the adult schools, workforce development, do a really good job, sometimes. We do a really good job with individuals who are not institutionally barriered. But there are certain groups, returning offenders, persons with disabilities, English language learners, who are represented in education, training, and workforce programs in much smaller numbers than they represent in the population. And one of the reasons, if you read between the lines of the state plan, is that for some of these individuals, the programs available aren't really very accessible. And that business might be would likely be very happy to have more manpower that harnessed all sorts of resources, including individuals with barriers. So we have to figure out how to make programs accessible to them so that they can access the skills, the knowledge, the education that they need to compete within the labor market. So let's start with the first question, which is the easiest one. This one is so easy, it's almost a throwaway. But I do want to get some ideas up on the flip chart about what resources are available in the community, what kinds of training programs. So let me start. So we're going to pass the mic around, and we're going to go to the front row, Michael. And just really quickly, state your name before you speak.
Can everybody hear?
Yep.
Shelley Addicks, I'm the Deputy Sector Navigator for the Community Colleges of our Valley and the Motherlode for Retail, Hospitality, Tourism, and Recreation. So we're the redhead stepchildren of all the sectors.
We like you anyway.
So I make my hair red.
Okay. So what resources do we have? Education, training resources.
Bakersfield is actually one of them. I'm out of Merced, at Merced College, as my host, but I actually spend a lot of time in Bakersfield because we have a wonderful relationship with KROC, with the KROC. And what we found is that...
So KROC is a?
KROC is your Career and Technical Education Center for downtown Bakersfield's high school system, K-12. My particular affiliation with that happened because, very unusually, I'm hosted by contract corporate education at my college, so I'm not for credit where I am. They're the folks that put in for two sectors of our region. Global Trade and Logistics and myself are both at that college in the not-for-credit.
Okay.
So what I wanted to say is that, in a very odd way, the college, Bakersfield College, did not contact us. It was KROC that did, and they did so through your contract education office at Bakersfield Community College, where it turns out, and this is the way we got into it, when the Tejon outlets were opening, and council member Leticia Perez hosted a workforce board circle, very successful, some of you might have been part of that, I was brought in to help support training, paying for trainers.
Okay.
So that's how we met, you guys.
Great.
It was retail, so it worked for my sector. And we paid, and we found out KROC has one of the most fabulous boot camp programs in the region where a high school...
We're going to talk about those resources in just a minute.
So it's youth, KROC, in conjunction with your contract ed division at the community college, actually working together to get in monies and trainers to do these boot camps.
So I'm going to list community colleges as another resource.
Right. But not just community. It's not credit, though. It's not for credit. That's where you guys don't realize that...
Community colleges are a resource, right? They're an education training resource.
There's three parts, though. There's adult ed, there's contract education, and there's credit, and they're all separate.
Right, but community colleges are a training resource.
Right.
Okay, excellent, thank you. Who else has a comment? These are all really, really simple, really obvious. Let's take that over here. Thank you very much. Hi, and just state your name and your comment.
Jennifer Patino from Cal State Bakersfield. Obviously, Cal State Bakersfield.
Well, and you know what, so not just Cal State Bakersfield, but if we look at the region largely, we could probably say four-year colleges and universities, right?
Yes.
And the local suspect being Cal State Bakersfield, right? Okay, excellent. Okay, who else? This is the easiest part of our discussion, right here.
So one of the sectors that has not really been named has been information technologies and software.
Yes.
So that is a growing field here. It may not represent as many jobs as the other sectors, but it is growing. So the KIC community is a local resource for those interested in learning about and creating innovations and technology.
So I was remiss not to include ICT among the list because it is on the list. It is smaller in the valley, perhaps, than other regions of the state, but absolutely there. So what was the resource you named?
KIT Community.
KIT, K-I-T?
Yeah,
K-I-T. And it stands for?
Kern Innovation and Technology.
Kern Innovation and Technology. Is it a school?
So we're working on nonprofit status.
So it is an organization?
Yes. The training, rather than having training programs, we have experiential learning opportunities.
Ooh, good.
Such as competitions, which are interdisciplinary and collaborative. So we work with CSUB to have a technology competition for libraries. And we're working with Bakersfield College to have a similar competition called a hackathon for public health.
Excellent. Okay, that's an unexpected resource. That's excellent that you brought that up. What other resources? Right here, this gentleman.
My name is.
Wait for the mic for a second. I only say that because we're being recorded.
Okay. My name is Saul. I work with the Department of Rehabilitation. Some pretty obvious workforce resources: mm-hmm. AJC, so America's Job Center.
Okay, thank you.
Other resources such as the Department of Rehabilitation, so Vocational Rehabilitation Services as a whole.
Excellent. Okay. Very good. Who else has other resources that we should be listing? The very tall gentleman in the back. You can't tell because he's seated, but he's quite menacing.
Menacing.
Because it's alliterative with your first name, which is?
Mark.
Thank you, Mark.
It's an alliteration, is that?
Yes.
Menacing Mark.
Menacing Mark.
Okay. Well, Bakersfield Adult
School. So adult schools. Now, I think in Bakersfield Adult School in particular, right? But throughout the region, you probably have other adult schools as well. Who else has some ideas of different resources? We need to lay these out first. Magda, right here.
Good morning. I would say nonprofits.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, that is one that sometimes it takes us a few minutes to get to. But CBOs or nonprofits, I have to tell you, 150 years ago, when I first started in this field, most of the hard skills training that the system was using was actually training that was delivered by nonprofits. It's interesting, much more connection out to the education community in the last 20 years, but nonprofits still play a role in job training and certainly in delivering workforce services. Excellent. What other ideas do you have? Right here, this gentleman right here in the back row.
Yes, my name's Brian Matthews. The unions and apprenticeship programs.
Excellent. Excellent. Unions and apprenticeship programs. Brian, are you with a union?
No.
No? Okay. Okay. So you represent the private sector. Which union do you work with?
I work with all the building trades here in Kern and Long County. I work for California Relevant, so we have a 22-mile section of our program.
Excellent. Okay. Very good. Right here.
Yes, there's also an organization called ABC, which is Associated Builders and Contractors, which is funded by local companies in that industry. and they pool their financial resources essentially to train for specific job.
Absolutely, and I'm so glad that you brought that up, because depending on where you are, business and industry associations, labor-led apprenticeship programs, and other kind of outside the educational system, the traditional education system, providers can play a much bigger role in training. What other ideas? Where else does training exist? There's several more that I know that you know. So let's see if we can list some of this gentleman right here. That's my friend John.
I have a private post-secondary school that we run. And we work real close with the Career Services Center here in town. And pretty effective, but we're pretty aggressive as well.
So we have an aggressive trade and technical school in our midst. Okay, that's good. What do you train for?
We're in the welding business.
Excellent. Okay, what else? What other resources do we have in the community? Let me ask you this. Compared to, I'm going to say 20 years ago, do people learn skills outside a brick and mortar context?
Yes.
So what would we call that kind of training? Online training, right? So we have all sorts of online programs. And in saying that, we're not necessarily diverging from the resources, the providers, the trainers that we've listed here, because all of these, including, I'm sure, Cal State San Bernardino, or excuse me, did I say that out loud? Cal State Bakersfield. I live in Palm, you're leaving now, yeah. So I live in Palm Springs, California, where we have no Cal State, but we do have a campus of Cal State San Bernardino. So you'll forgive me?
I do.
Okay, thanks. Anything else that we want to add to this list? Yeah, this gentleman right here. But you have to wait for a mic?
Not really. My name is Bill. Kind of different, but I think it's important to AJCC, the on-the-job training program.
Yes. So I'm going to take that, and I'm going to broaden it and call it work-based learning / employer-delivered, employer-sponsored training. And we got a little bit of that before, because a gentleman in the back brought up apprenticeship programs, which are delivered at least in part in a work-based context, but more and more the workforce system is making use of work-based learning modalities, so we would be remiss not to include those on our list as a resource. Anything else you want to add to this list? Anything else come to mind? Yes, right here at this young lady. She's got an embarrassment of microphones. Okay,
so there is a new program that's just started this year. It's for youth. Mm-hmm. It's called The Next Step. And these are the kids that are out of high school.
Next Step?
Mm-hmm. They're out of high school. They were in the foster care, and they're kind of like left hanging.
Who's the deliverer?
I can't remember her name, but she just started it. She got a grant. Through the White House.
So is it a non-profit organization? Okay, so this is delivered by a non-profit.
Yeah, $3 million grant for that.
So you know what this is illustrative of is projects. Some training are delivered on a project basis. There's a single fund stream, and then a project is developed around them. There's a woman in the back has a comment. What else do we have?
Conversation that CBE and the Chancellor's Office for Community Colleges have been collaborating on implementing career pathways programs. These are seamless sets of curriculum that do not duplicate.
Right.
And they are required to include both work-based learning and dual enrollment kinds of opportunities.
Excellent.
And there is a fairly significant project that's ongoing in this region in 9 pathways, and as a result of that work that's been going on for about a year, there are several additional pathways that are being developed.
What is your name?
Bonita.
Hi, Bonita. Hi. So we're going to just, I think we're almost done listing kind of, you know, the resources and the providers, and then I'm gonna actually come back to Bonita, and I'm going to ask for some descriptions of that, because we're going to want to take a look at whether or not these resources are providing in-demand skills, and I think when you talk about the work you're doing with Pathways, you're answering that question. So we're going to come back to that in a minute, okay? Yes, right here.
So my name is Alyssa. I don't know if I mentioned that in the first one, but we also have unique sort of industries, sponsored schools or programs.
Mm-hmm.
So like Project Lead the Way, which are in high schools.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also have Grimwayne Farms Academy, and I think Wonderful also has one. So they're industry-sponsored programs or entire schools.
So that is not too far afield from this notion of work-based learning, but you're talking about inside of particular schools.
Training for the employees of schools.
Right.
So they are employees that are being trained, but they're beneficiaries in some way.
So this is for incumbent workers, is what you're making a note of in some cases?
No, I think it's for children of workers.
Okay.
For one of them, for, I think it's Grimway or Wonderful. Yeah, so they're for the agricultural communities.
Excellent. Okay. What else? Any other programs or resources? We can get down to this woman right here. Hi.
I'm Sandra Milchstedt at Taft High School, but there are career academies in all of
yes.
the schools in this area.
So high school career academies.
Which marry academics and CTE education.
Absolutely. That's a good one to have down here. Any other resources you want to list? There's a couple that come to mind for me. You want me to list a couple? Why not? I'm here too. So I think I'm here. So one of them that I think we didn't list here is because we don't have one nearby Kern County. And that is a, if I'm gonna write, Job Corps Center. Okay. Throughout the nation, there are, I think, 120 Job Corps centers. I think our nearest one to here, you guys need to help me out with this, may be Los Angeles. So in California, we have them, we have one in the Inland Empire, two in Los Angeles County, one in Sacramento, one in the Bay Area. Job Corps is a USDOL funded program serving individuals 16 through 24. Often the Job Corps centers are residential programs, so young people can live there, they can earn a high school diploma at the same time that they train for a job. What programs are working? Let's talk about our successes first, because again, in terms of trying to write a regional plan that talks about what we're capable of accomplishing within the region. I think if we take a look at where, that's perfect. See the wonderful job that you've done there? Thank you, Michael. If we take a look at these resources, if we could think about what programs are working to impart skills in any of the areas we looked at. Remember we talked about foundational skills, academic skills, hard skills, welding being a good example of a hard skill, or just life skills, soft skills. Now's the time to talk about what's working. So who'd like to get us started on that? Some of you already got us started on that, and I reined you in a little bit, but now's the time to address that. Right here, this gentleman. And I'm done writing.
Thank you. Luis Lopez, I represent an employer. So what worked for us would be the OJTs on the job training. We've had some several successes from it. Just recently we hired a cook, and now he's a mechanic high-pressure tester, and he's done phenomenal. So the incentive from the OJT on getting reimbursed some of the initial training wages is a great initiative for us to partner with the American Job Center, and that's one that comes to mind.
So Luis, I'm gonna ask you a couple of questions about that, because I think you said some things that really kind of captured my interest there. So Luis is talking about a particular training mechanism that's available under our Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act funded programs through the centers that Employers Training Network and the Workforce Development Board operate. So under OJT, the trainer is, as we saw here, as we saw right there, the trainer is the business. The notion being that for some occupations, the best way to impart skills, hard skills typically, is in a work environment. And so the center and the business come together and they develop a training plan, and ostensibly they prepare a curriculum, if you will, in short order for that individual. How long was the OJT? How long did it take to turn a cook into what job?
It's still in the process. It's a high pressure tester.
In what sort of business?
Oil and gas.
Oil and gas. So how long is that OJT for?
I believe it's about 480 hours.
Okay, so that's about a 12-week on the job training.
Yes.
Okay. And why do you think that that's such an effective way of delivering skills?
Well, it comes down to building. I think a lot of people need jobs out there, but we got to get the right person for the right job. And what Bill has done for us is help us filter through candidates that will make it through this, or at least we're betting that they will. And then us, we can train anybody. We just need somebody that's smart. So that answers your question.
It does. I'm listening to you, and I'm thinking about school-based learning versus work-based learning. And I went to school, and for me, it worked out pretty well. I'm here before you today because I'm a product of school. You know,
I did not fit pretty well because of somebody training me. Okay. But I was able
to
get up early,
right?
Buy my shoes,
right?
Be on time, and then I had some great mentors. But I was lined up in the right job.
See, and this is what I wanted us to kind of focus on. So see, for Luis, he describes his pathway to success being learning and gaining skills and preparing for a job through work-based learning opportunities. And for me, my path was an educational path that relied on K-12 and the college system. Different learners have different preferences in terms of style. They react differently to different learning environments. And some people learn well both ways. And so when we talk about what the colleges are doing in greater kind of, with greater regularity nowadays, they're doing a lot of these bridge programs where someone will take some classes. It's like an apprenticeship model where there's some academic study, but then there's a handoff so they learn in the field. And that's what you were speaking to, and I didn't want us to lose track of that. I think that's really important, Luis.
I do believe, David, that I think we need to do a better job trying to figure out what people are better fitted to. I don't want to send somebody to college and spend our tax money when they're not going to get through it, or they're not going to land a job. So I think that's where the problem starts, to me, is trying to, like I mentioned at the beginning, a lot of people need a job. I would classify people out there, and I mentioned it before, that there's A, B, C's, and D, and F type of people, personalities. So finding those A type of people out there, meaning like the really smart people, are the ones that need to go through these programs, the ones that we need to employ first, because employing these people first will, in a sense, make business more successful, open more job positions for then the B's, the C's, D's, and so on. But if you find somebody, just the first person that walks into you and you send them to the program, they get hired, and they're maybe the classification of an F, which they do need a job, by the way, but they're not successful, and they don't make the business successful, the business will shut down. And we don't want that. We want to stimulate the economy, so we need to put the good people to work first. So I think doing a better job finding who those A players are, maybe through some testing that we do to try to figure out.
Well, we're gonna come to a question at the end, which is how to make training accessible and work for everyone. So we'll come back to that point. How's that? Okay, who else would like to share about what programs they think are doing a good job of preparing people for jobs that are available in our local economy? Or I know some of you are from out of the area, so anywhere in the Valley. Mark.
At Bakersfield Adult School, we have quite a few successful programs, from our health careers program, which MA, NA, all the way to LVN.
Okay.
We've got medical coding and billing. We've got a 1600 cafe that just opened up at America's Job Center that really emphasizes the soft skills and the teamwork, and that's been a very successful program. We've started an IT program of cabling, network cabling. We're doing that. We've got a lot of things going on. We do a lot of the foundational skills with our EL programs, and our family leadership programs out in the community. Jody, anything else?
I want you to talk for just a second about the role that your institution plays in teaching soft skills. I think that's interesting. That's maybe, you know, some of what you talked about in terms of what you're doing in terms of the healthcare career pathway or even the ICT career pathway. That's not unexpected for me to hear, you know, a person in your position say that. But when you talked about the work you're doing in terms of soft skills training, that's a little different for school, because I can tell you, I didn't learn a lot of soft skills in school. So I think that is something that business is telling us more and more that they need and they want to see in all applicants, in all workers. So what are you doing in that arena?
Well, the arena that's really flourished, in my opinion, is our cafe, our 1600 cafe.
Talk about that. I'm not sure I know what that is.
Well, it's a working restaurant. Mm-hmm. It's a culinary. That's what we started as a culinary arts program. We decided to incorporate two teachers. One teacher be in the back of the house that would focus on the preparation of the food, basically the chef. And then we had a front of the house that was kind of be an entrepreneurial part. But as it evolved, it quickly became apparent that front of the house was really dealing with a lot of the soft skills that we're talking about, working on a team. It was kind of like Luis was saying about hiring a chef to do the high pressure. We've got a couple of students that have just shown tremendous leadership skills, but they've taken this restaurant. It's a working restaurant. This is not a slow play. This is something every day they've got to prepare the food. They've got to set it out. They get to create it. They've been, we give them a lot of those skills as well. But the teamwork concept and the soft skills, just getting along, really, those things were things that we weren't really understanding. That wasn't our intent when we initially started, but it became so apparent early on that that was one of the most important things that our students were learning. But I think it's the actual environment of a fast-paced a restaurant, an American bistro. We're not a slow style sit-down service. We're serving, you know, approximately 80 to 100 customers a day. They get evaluated basically almost every person that takes a meal there. But it's been really kind of an unexpected was the amount of soft skills that they were getting and the ability to work on the team. And that's, I see these students now in a whole different light. Those skills are so transferable to wherever they go. We work with some of the students, and we're not just looking for jobs in the culinary industry. We're looking for jobs outside the culinary industry for these students as well. But it was really kind of an aha moment when we got in there and started to do it. Really, I think so many of our potential students could benefit from going through our culinary arts program.
You know, so not unexpectedly, you describe a number of training programs where the modality, the way that they train, is didactic. You teach it, a teacher teaches it, there's a lesson plan, people listen, they learn, they may take notes, they take tests, etc. But by virtue of this cafe, you are able to provide a modality which is a work-based modality. And one of the things besides the culinary school, the hospitality, the culinary skills they're learning, are these workplace behaviors. So one of the things that Mark suggests to us is that when we take a look at we were thinking about foundational skills, academic skills, hard skills, soft skills. One of the places we can teach soft skills is right here in this work-based learning environment. It's not the curriculum per se that is imparting those skills to the young people working in the cafe. It's the work itself. And I love the fact that you said you used twice the word just working as part of a team, because it's something, soft skills are something that we want to minimize. All of us, myself included, when we start talking about soft skills, we'll say things like Mark did, well, just showing up on time. You know, well, it's not just showing up on time, it's you absolutely, positively must show up on time. So, you know, it's something that we can minimize, but it's essential to workplace success. So I want to hear a lot more about soft skills. This young lady, then John, then Benita. So right here.
I just wanted to find out
your name first?
Oh, my name is Katrina.
Where are you from?
From Freely.
Oh, excellent.
Actually, a recent transplant to Bakersfield. But what you were saying in terms of teamwork in that aspect, it got me thinking in terms of K through 12 sports organizations. I noticed that Bakersfield has a lot of sports community related to it, mm-hmm. and that actually frees up teamwork and some of those other soft skills that we do, that we're hoping that candidates will have.
You know, it's a really interesting, tell me your name again.
Katrina
just brought to us our attention a really big topic. And that big topic is one that comes up in all of these forums, no matter what, you know, we do forums on career pathways and industry value credentials, but a topic that keeps coming up over and over again is at what level should we start providing career education, even as simple as just what jobs are in the world of work, you know, to young people. I can tell you, I started to have that education, a person of my elderly status, in college. That was the first place I was really exposed to careers. And not early in college, as I got ready for graduation, where somebody turned to me and said, what do you intend to do with that degree in Spanish literature? FUD. Yeah, and I hadn't really thought about it. I just thought, well, I guess I'll teach. I don't know, can you do anything else with it? But I mean, I had had virtually no career planning, and I was at the precipice of, you know, of completing a degree. So what you just shared is that it suggests to us, you know, if there are things happening in our community, like sports, like organized sports, should we be using those as opportunities to teach workplace behaviors? Should we be doing so, I don't know, in sixth grade, in eighth grade, in kindergarten? How many of you think that we should expose kids to the world of work as early as the eighth grade? Just raise your hand. And leave it up if you think that should start in the sixth grade. How many of you think that should start in the fourth grade? How many of you think it should start in kindergarten? And let's see, there's fewer hands. So we can disagree a little bit about that. But if I said this, how many of you think we should start exposing young people to careers as they're in the last month of their senior year? How many of you think that's not a real good idea, is it? It's too late. We should be, you know, I can remember what career exposure looked like when I was a kid. I don't know, every year or so, I mean, not year or so, I'm going to say once or twice throughout the year, they would march somebody in front of us in the auditorium, and it might be a fireman. You know, or it might be a doctor. And the doctor always wore a stethoscope, and he was always a man. I think they were all the same person. They just came, you know, in different forms of, you know, different costumes and get-up. Actually, the one I knew it wasn't a put-on was when my best friend's mom showed up. And you talk about a trailblazer. She was an attorney. And for my age, nobody's mom was an attorney. I mean, now everybody's mother was Betty Crocker, you know. And it's funny because Lorraine is now 92 and she just went into senior living kicking and screaming because she was, you know, very much a feminist trailblazer and, you know, still has a mind of her own. But yeah, that was our version of career exposure, and it wasn't a lot. It didn't make us think, you know, really a lot about what we wanted to be. And we had no idea how to get there. It was a great big mystery. You know, in would walk the doctor, but we didn't understand what it would take for us to be a doctor. So you raise an important point. Let's go to John. Are you wired?
Am I wired?
Uh-huh. A different question, does your mic work?
Sometimes it works.
Okay.
That's the thing with my angle is, the first thing I have to do when they send me somebody to train is to figure out who this guy is or girl. Mm-hmm.
And you operate a trade school, right?
I do.
Okay.
I do. So in the welding business, there's all kind of different jobs. So this person that comes to me, he tells me, he says, John, or his grandfather tells me, I have a problem with my son, my grandson. He can't read or write. I said, okay, so what's the problem? He said, I just told you. I said, if he's reading or writing, he's not welding. So I don't have any use for him. Where I'm trying to go with this is, every person has a different ability to learn. If you don't know what you're dealing with, how do you train him? Set him in a classroom with everybody else that's been to college or somewhere else, some university, and try to train him what I know? You won't get it. So I train them each one specific. James, for a matter of fact, he's a simple kid, was raised on a farm, started working probably when he was 5 years old, feeding cattle, taking care of, bringing hay up, all this kind of stuff. Best student I got. You know why? Shows up every day, on time, early, telling me it's time to go to work. He don't know nothing from nothing, but he knows how to work. So let me sum it up. I could talk all night long on this deal.
Please don't. No, I'm kidding.
No, you're right. But the thing is you guys, so I get him in there. I figure out where his strong points are. I found out where he's weak, okay? And then all I got to do now is just give him what I do. And every bit of it's different. What I'm trying to get to is everybody has a different level. Mm-hmm. Everybody's employable. Here's one deal. I'm working in Bay Area, okay? I'm 300 feet in the air, and I need a bag of bolts. That's what James does. How important is he now? He's real important because he never misses one of them. He's got the same amount all the time. He's got the right ones. That's all his job is, to make sure I get them on time, because I'm costing those people tons of money. So he's just as important as everybody else. All I'm saying is I train specific. So before I find out who the guy is, mm-hmm. I won't know how to train him.
Okay, so here is, and I appreciate your comments, John, and here's where I think we can all agree in terms of what you're saying. One of the things we need to do is we need to be able to assess people to determine what their learning style is. And whether we agree or disagree with your comments on, you know, whether literacy and numeracy matter, I think is a matter of perspective. But it is important that we do good assessments. And you know what I think precede a good assessment? Is good career exploration and information. Goes back to the comments we were making a moment ago about at what point should we start to expose kids to career opportunities. You know, a lot of young people begin to participate in some sort of vocational training without really understanding what the jobs are about. And you know, there are systems that give young people the opportunity to shadow, try out, intern, do work experience, observe, etc., so they get a taste of what's out there, so they make better, more informed, better planned, if you will, decisions about careers. Are we up with Benita next? Yes.
This is probably a good moment for me to jump in to this conversation. So in the college and career pathways project I described earlier, one of the things that wasn't funded by the project but was agreed upon by all the partners was to make sure that every freshman got a semester-long college and career exploration course. And that course is followed up as a sophomore, as a junior, and as a senior. Mm. And when they finished the semester course as a freshman, they created a 10-year career plan.
Right.
That includes education. It's not just college, it's trade schools, it's post-secondary of all kinds of flavors, including apprenticeships and other kinds of career training. The program also is embedding career readiness throughout these career pathways. So every year that there is a career pathway piece for that student embedded in that is career readiness. We've been working with KCSOS, and maybe Robbie was.
KCSOS?
Superintendent of Schools.
Oh, hi, Superintendent of Schools.
I'm not the Superintendent of Schools, it's but, Kern County Superintendent right. of Schools is the office.
Right.
So we partner with this group, and we're working on the same the soft skills that you're talking about. Mm-hmm. So we're deliberately creating lessons in grades K through 14, highly engaging lessons around career readiness skills / soft skills / power skills, whatever you want to call them, in a very deliberate way in order to provide specific training related to those soft skills. So we're creating these modules of learning as well. And we see that we need to reach down, frankly, all the way to kindergarten, but we're focusing currently on grades 7 through 9.
Tell me your name again.
Rob Arias.
So, Rob, I have a question, and Benita, you can answer it too. So, when we talk about, so when Mark was talking, he was describing to us the cafe environment and how just almost organically they had this realization that young people were learning soft skills, by virtue of being involved in work. They were learning to accept supervision, to work as part of a team, to think critically, to show up on time, to organize workflow, all the kind of soft skills employers are begging for. So that happened in a work-based environment. When you talk about the work that you all are doing with regard to soft skills, how are you teaching it? I'm really interested to know that.
We're really not there yet. We're still developing the lessons themselves. And we're going to be rolling that out and piloting it in terms of how you teach it. But we're going to make it available. It'll be free online. It'll be available to every teacher in Kern County and actually beyond. So it's really, we're trying to draw youth in by using video as kind of the anticipatory set to put kids into learning and using video production by students to help create those videos as well. So, and then you have instructions. We want it to be very much plug and play for a teacher, so it can be used at any level, very easily accessible, and kind of fun.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I'm going to insert something that may not even be apropos to this topic, but when you talk about video and using video as a means of teaching and as imparting skills, I was doing one of these sessions the other day in Glendale. For LA. Anyone know where Glendale is? What's next to Burbank? And Burbank is home to Disney and several other of the studios. And so this was a business person who dealt mostly in television and motion picture production. She had a small business that was a contractor to them. And there was this whole notion about that she talked about art being a foundational skill. Remember I said the literacy, reading and writing are your foundational skills. And she rose her hand and she said, well, what about art? And I said, well, what about it? And she said that because, in her words, we have moved from the information age to the visual age. I didn't know that. She told me we did, but I didn't know we had done that. But she said we had moved to the visual age, and so much of what we take in, including education, including training, is in the form of video, that art is now a fundamental skill. I just had to share that with you because that was a learn. That was, I looked, you know, this was my Oprah moment. I looked under my chair for the keys to my new Chevy, and they weren't there. But I found it interesting. Benita.
I wanted to add one more thing to that piece. So while Rob and his team are working on these videos for K-12, mm-hmm. our core team, our existing pathways groups, are embedding the industry's culture in each pathway.
How do you embed the industry's culture in the pathway?
Let's take, for example, construction.
Okay.
In many of our construction fields here in Kern County, they'll have a thing called a gate meeting, a tailgate meeting. That's where they talk about safety. They create that every day as part of their environment in the classroom. And so they embed these kinds of industry-specific cultural knowledges, practices, into the teaching environment. The other thing I wanted to mention, too, is that this college and career pathway mm-hmm. is not just for the comprehensive high schools.
Sure.
It's involving the alternative high schools, the continuation high schools, adult schools. It's involving a significant share of our folks
okay.
throughout the county.
Very good. We're going to go right here to my friend from Cal State, Bakersfield.
Thank you. So everybody knows.
Name your, again?
Jennifer.
Hi, Jennifer.
Okay. Everybody knows what CSUB and all the other CSUs and four-year colleges do, but my job at CSUB is actually pretty cool because I'm the director of professional development, which means I get to do what I think is the funnest job on campus, is I get to help adults. So those age 18, those are adults, believe it or not, sometimes when older. No offense to any of our younger people in the group. I help them develop skills that can be used to get either a new job or a better job, or in the job you have, move up in your career. And some of the certificate programs that I have that I'm actually very proud of is we have a pharmacy tech program. Mm. We have a new program that starts in January, which is the GIS, which is Geographic Information Systems. That will be starting. We also have safety and risk. So, Benita, thank you for mentioning safety. that is one of our most popular classes that we've had. We've had that for about 22 years. And we've probably seen about 1,000 students go through that, men and women. And that one, I can personally attest to as changing lives, because my husband took that class and has provided a very good life for me and my family, besides me working and going to school as well.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, he was one of those people who didn't like school and only went to high school.
Mm-hmm.
So he has always kind of had, I think he's felt bad that he didn't want to go to college and didn't want to have a, you know, what I always felt, or what he thinks I always felt,
sure,
a job that was, more education providing. But I didn't care about that kind of things. That was his own stuff. Well, he did our safety and risk training and done a really good job at DC Electric and has done phenomenal. But, you know, there's training and skills and certificate programs at CSUB and other four-year colleges, as well as BC. It's not just degree programs. And there are four people that have high school diplomas and sometimes not even high school diplomas. So there's things out there that doesn't have to just be a degree program for those that, you know, say, well, I don't really like college.
Right.
We have certificate programs as well.
So you bring to mind for me a question. So I have kind of a sub question for the group. So when we're talking about programs that provide trainees the skills needed for demand occupations, whether they're soft skills or hard skills, one of the things suggested to us in our state workforce plan, and there is, it's a published plan. So just like we're developing the regional plan that I spoke of, and there are local plans. So Michael's in charge of shepherding the local plan for Kern Inyomono's workforce region here. There's this state plan. And one of the things that is embedded in there, kind of like hard rock, is this notion that when we can deliver skills in smaller units that stack upon each other, we make training more accessible. And the extent to which those stackable units are modular, you don't necessarily need one. This one doesn't have to go on top of this one, but some, you know, there might be the first one, then you could go here or here. And the extent to which those stackable units might be portable, that they're portable from one region to the next, they're that much more valuable. So I'd like to get your thoughts about what training do we have here in the Valley that looks like that? Anyone able to speak to that? Stackable training, smaller units. How about right here?
They have CIS modules. CIS.
No, go ahead and take. Okay. Go ahead. We'll trade off.
So they have these CIS modules.
Spell it.
SISC.
Okay, and what does that stand for? That's the hard part. We don't know what it stands for. It's a mystery. It's like hieroglyphics. SISC. So they're modules. And are at the high school level?
You're talking about CIS, the insurance company?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's our local health provider resource. And CIS stands for...
Do we want to give him a mic?
Self-Insured Schools Corporation or...
Okay, what are the modules though? What are the learning modules? Oh, you know, so we don't know. We don't know what they are? Okay. Anyone else have any ideas, any thoughts around stackable learning? Right here, Shelley.
Hospitality has something, people think of food handler cards called ServSafe.
Yes.
But every commercial kitchen in California by state regulation has to have a ServSafe manager, certified manager. That's a sanitation exam given by very strict Proctor standards. It's the National Restaurant Association.
Yes.
And if you're moving up from entry level at a restaurant, that's what you want to shoot for. At Merced College, the not-for-credit side offers it. We have a adjunct faculty come over and teach it for the public. For, I think it's under $300, you get
right.
That upgrade in your credential, and it goes with you anywhere, not just California, but all across the U.S. Hospitality has the certified customer service gold.
Right.
And that's what I was doing for the K-Rock system here as I came down. They gave the high school boot camp, and then I got the hospitality industry test for them so that they can be certified, and that goes with them globally for the rest of their life. It says, I know above and beyond service, 75% of the kids in the area, just to let everybody know, were passing with flying colors, whether they had banking as their goal or retail or I don't know what I want to do, but I'm studying customer service. And we said, above and beyond service, here's scenarios, here's an exam, Scantron and everything went to the national office. They had to pass a test that hoteliers pass, and three-quarters pass it all across the valley. So our kids know they need incentives, though, and recognition. I might put a word in for food service, nothing like tips to teach you what the value of customer service is.
Right, right.
Half of us go through college doing a job in this sector anyway. That's the national statistic. That's how we, half of the U.S. workforce learns these, is the boot camp is working a minimum wage tip job.
Absolutely.
That's where we're learning it. And so if we lose validation for that and we talk it down, most of us did, you know, we were at the Dairy Queen when we were 16. Okay. That's how we learned these things.
How many of you,
I
actually want to validate what you just said, which is how many of you had a first job or second or third job in hospitality or food service, McDonald's or anything like that? So most of us in this room started in that industry. And I'm with you, Shelley. We can't talk down hospitality and food service because it was an on-ramp to the world of work for me. And am I using I was a waiter. I wasn't a good waiter, but I was a waiter. And I would have to make up with, I'd have to use my scintillating personality very often to make up for my Jerry Lewis-like delivery of food skills. But you're right, it provided all of us who did that exposure to working with the public, customer service skills, working as part of a team, etc. Very good. Any other thoughts about stackable credentials, or any other thought? Right, this gentleman right here. And your name first.
My name is Greg Forgiveney, and my company offers, or commercially we have, electro automation programming, PLC programming training we do with our industry partners that, you know, our customers pay for to train their workers. We also try to, you know, right now it's like we're trying to help help get the curriculum to places like CSU, but really Bakersfield College has an automation program.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a pre-canned curriculum, basically a free educator at a cost of textbooks that you could have, but it seems like there's reluctance maybe to take a commercially available training program and adopt it for, you know, widely adopt for whatever reason. Maybe, I don't know, the cost obviously to industry is fairly high for each course, but it's still valuable because it gives them a specific skill how to program or how to operate different intelligent devices. But that training is available, and if people say, hey, we want to buy this training and do it, you could. You just have to, you know, pay for it, obviously, because it's proprietary information, just like any textbook that I point out. Like, well, it's proprietary industrial stuff. You go, yeah, so are textbooks, and you pay for those through the nose. So I think it's something that could be there, and if people wanted it, they could have it. They just never really said, oh, we want to do that.
So do you represent a business that internally developed training modules to train people for your business?
No, we actually manufactured it, but yeah, all the stuff devices and everything we provide and sell and configure and everything else through our company, through a distributor, is already there, it's already done. So conceivably, you could have that training if you wanted to buy it, and you could train everybody in the world on this training if you were willing to pay for it. Just like I said, it's proprietary information.
Okay.
Or, you know, it's a, like, you know, I just say proprietary, but I'll say it's already been developed, like textbooks have been developed, so you just have to pay for the content, and you could do it. It's just a matter of, I guess, reluctance to certain, you know, commercially available things or whatever. I don't know that it's not as widespread, but, you know, several times the amount of customers could have this stuff if they're willing to have it up front, and if the company's willing to do it, it's just nobody's asked us really to provide that, but they very much are willing to train people to do what we do. It's just a matter of the willingness to pay for it,
right,
and have someone instructed.
And the training is for advanced manufacturing?
Yeah, it's for industrial automation.
Okay, I was just trying to...
Manufacturing, right, would use it, exactly.
Sure, I'm just trying to put it into an industry context. Okay, you know, that raises another point too, and I'm going to go to Benita right now, but I'd like the others of you to think too about what we're doing here in the region with regard to hard skills, because that, you know, we've talked about soft skills, we talked a little bit about foundational skills, less about the hard skills. The gentleman talked about welding, you know, for a variety of sectors. We talked a little bit about advanced manufacturing. Benita, what you may want to talk about something else.
To give an example of an industry recognized set of trainings, the NCCBR core construction skills is being taught by the Economic Workforce Development Division of the Kern Community College District. It's also being taught by Kern High School at the ROC and at their comprehensive schools. And I think possibly also at the adult school, as well as associated builders and contractors. So I think when some of these, what you might call proprietary training modules, when they have that level of recognition, whether it's from the hospital association or the retail association or the automation manufacturers, and then I think that's where you start to see those kinds of curricula being picked up by folks. And there have been a number of people here on the southern end of the valley that have participated with Fresno on several advanced manufacturing grants that have included exploration of some of the manufacturing. I'm forgetting the association's name. So I'm not sure if it's started to be adopted or not, but I know there are examples of it. Of where industry-recognized training and credentials do get adopted.
Okay. Who else has any comments about hard skills training, where we're training people for manufacturing, for healthcare, for construction, for value-added ag? What other training are we doing that we think is particularly good, that portends success were it to be scaled up beyond, say, you know, the city of Bakersfield or beyond a particular district or provider? What are your thoughts on that? I know there are a lot of people here who represent training in one form or another. So where do you think we're doing the best training, for instance, for healthcare? I'll throw that out. Where is that happening? And where are we creating on-ramps so that people in that field can upskill after they're in the field?
Bakersfield Adult School.
Bakersfield Adult School? Okay, well, okay, that being said, but how about the how part of it?
Yeah, Bakersfield Adult School is the best.
Okay. There you go. Thank you for that commercial announcement. Right, it's Alyssa, right? Okay, so let's bring a mic to Alyssa.
So I know that Bakersfield College just started a public health program, and they're closely working with community partners so that students learn more about what they can do with that sort of degree, what sort of colleges they can transfer to, what the career pathway is, and to bring people from those professions in to talk. But I also know that the impression I got from CSUB's health programs, not just medical and the science department, health management and other fields, is that they very closely work with industry so that all of the students have a clear idea of what they can do with that degree, and employers get to see potential talent earlier.
Yeah. You know, so you actually make me think of something else, Alyssa, by those comments. So for healthcare, for instance, we've got a lot of standardized classifications. And by standardized classifications, they're job titles that we're all really familiar with. Registered nurse, licensed vocational nurse, pharmacy tech. I guess there's a radiology tech. There's pretty much a tech position for everything. There's a, you know, from the in terms of direct care, you know, from the lowest level of home health aide or medical assistant, et cetera. We have all of these very common titles. I'm just wondering how in the region we are gathering intelligence from the business community to get their input on what content should look like. So that would apply to medical or anything else. But here's the question. So if we're trying to train people to perform jobs that are in demand, in occupations that are growing as part of, you know, our targeted sectors, how are we engaging with business around content so that our content is current. So right here. So.
For the certificate programs that I have at CSUB, I usually do advisory groups. Mm-hmm. And for the pharmacy tech program in particular, because we're talking healthcare, my instructor is a local pharmacist, and I have an advisory board of local pharmacists, pharmacy owners, pharmacy techs.
Okay, so the school itself is talking to, puts together a group.
I can't talk for main campus. Mm-hmm. I can only speak for, I work in the extended university, okay. Even though it is CSUB, extended university, we are a little bit of a separate entity.
So, you speaking right to the next question I have. So even within your university, you can't speak from one campus to the next. Here's what we're hearing from industry throughout these forums. One of the concerns is that if I come to the AJC and I speak to a job developer, a business outreach person, maybe someone who's staff like yourself, and I say, bring me a welder, I need a welder. And then you go to John over there and he's got a welder, and then you go to the community college and they have welders, and then the adult school system has welders, I don't know if you do or not, I'm making this up, and you present three or four candidates, all of whom are newly minted welders by virtue of having completed a class or a course or a program, they're presenting with vastly different skills. So that's the question. How, as a region, are we engaging with business and industry so that we understand better what the industry as a whole wants and needs? There's no simple answer to this question. I'm just wondering what your thoughts are about it.
That's always been an issue at CSUB. Okay. And I think one of the issues is because extended university, we are a little bit, we're self-support. Mm-hmm. So we do have a little bit more flexibility than main campus because they are such, they have to follow state. And not that we don't have to, but we are self-support.
But the whole point is if we're separately engaging the call, your branch of your university, another branch of your university, the community college here, the community college there, the adult school here, the private straight school there, we're all talking to business separately in our own little silo. Right. Are we getting the same information? So we're, the reason that one might believe that, it would be that the products we're producing have vastly different skill sets. Who has any thoughts? Or I saw a couple of hands go up for a second. So Benita in the back. Okay, ladies, I am going to call on you in a minute. So pick a question you like, okay? Because I've heard nothing from this very attractive group of women in the back here who are very silent.
I'm sorry, I apologize. I feel like I've been dominating this meeting. I don't intend to, but this is something that our group has been struggling with. We are trying to break this silo mold. Mm-hmm. We are actually in the planning stages of a larger industry engagement seminar workshop. And we're looking for mechanisms to better address this whole issue where, you know, high schools and ROC and adult schools and colleges, as you described, they all have separate advisories. Mm-hmm. And they're all getting different information. And we're trying to break that silo and figure out how to get down to the content so that we are certain that we have, number one, embedded in our programs the type of skills and competencies and knowledge that graduates need.
Okay.
So we recognize this is a challenge and we're certainly working on it as well. And I would extend an invitation to any of you here that if you'd like to work on this with me, give me your card. John, I got you. Give me your card and let's work on it together.
So I was just going to ask the woman, except she's not here anymore, she just left from economic development, about what we could do to kind of come together, at least in this part of the valley, and engage with business. So besides business engagement, I do want to move to the last couple of questions, and without reading them, here's what they're about. They're about accessibility, and you all have spoken to this, those of you who've talked about this. You got us started, Lewis, on this topic about people learn in different ways. People come into the job market with different levels of preparedness. And so one of the things that we face here in the Valley that we've heard, the reason I can say this is because we've talked to so many people. There's a chasm, there's a gap between what businesses are asking for and the skills that our workforce comes into the marketplace with. They're asking for A, B, C, D, E, F, G skills, and our workers are coming into the application process as candidates with A and B. And so there's a big gap between what workers present with and what businesses need in some of the critical occupations within growth industries. Industrial mechanics come to mind. A number of the not entry level, but mid-skill jobs in healthcare that require more technical skills. ICT, you started us out on that thought. So how do we make training programs more accessible for all learners? In our communities here, we have people who didn't finish high school, who have deficits in terms of literacy and numeracy. They don't read or write at levels that make them good candidates for most jobs. We've got people who've grown up in poorer communities who grew up without computer equipment, so their tech skills may lack behind. We have people who are returning offenders. They come back to our communities, and it's to everyone's benefit, is it not, that returning offenders get jobs, because that's how they reintegrate. We have people who are immigrants, who are English language learners, who lack communication skills that could pose a barrier, and on and on and on. I don't have to tell you about, you know, who's left out, because you've experienced that no matter what job you do, and from the people I've met in this room. What are your thoughts about making training and education programs more accessible to individuals with barriers? If you assume that everyone can learn, then just the intervention needs to be different. Magda.
I think that we will improve our services to the folks you just named, because frankly, we're not doing what we can do. But I think in particular programs, you know, we have those performance marks.
Right. Some of our funding requires that we perform.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And what happens when you do that is you cream.
She used the word cream, meaning you take just the best off the top. Right.
You know, and you understand that, you know, to keep funding coming, you do have to meet performance indicators. But I think And I don't know that it's at this level, but I think folks that give us these performance levels need to understand that in the long run, the folks that we are not serving, those are the folks that cost us as a society the most. Mm-hmm. Okay. And we greatly need to improve accessibility and services to those populations.
So, you know, one of the things I'm hearing you say, Magda, and correct me if I'm wrong because I don't want to put words in your mouth, but one of the things I'm hearing is that maybe part of what we should do in terms of our regional planning is a little legislative advocacy and just policy advocacy around, yeah, we understand their performance measures.
At this point, all we do is negotiate with the state, you know, look at our unemployment and, you know, 25% of our people, you know, can you lower our performance standards?
Maybe for certain populations. Yeah.
Negotiate.
Sure, okay. Sure.
But I think that, you know, you're right. You know, legislatively, you know, we do need to, you know, improve, advocate.
What other thoughts do you have about more accessible programs? Let's go right here. I haven't heard from this friend yet. My new best friend who I haven't met yet. Hi.
Hello. This goes along with the
podcast. What's your name?
Shonda. And I've been working at American Job Center for a really long time.
Mm-hmm.
And a few years ago, we developed a training program for warehouse logistics.
Okay.
And we brought everyone together. So we had the college and university training providers. We spoke to over 100 employers to get their input.
Wow.
Developed great training. Program itself was great. Our problem was exactly what Mom was talking about. Because we're held to funding guidelines,
mm-hmm.
these clients couldn't pay for the training themselves. So So in order for someone to pay for it, it had to be a specific group of individuals that qualified for this training, but they didn't really have a passion for that industry. So I don't think that they were assessed appropriately. They had no interest in it. So we sent all of these people through the training, 20 individuals. Not one of them got a job in that industry.
And so when you, on the topic of accessibility, you actually, this is a real interesting fable that you tell us here, because the, you know, the moral of that fable is that we can take, you know, underserved, under-resourced individuals, but doesn't change the need to do what we just said earlier, is you need to do a good assessment, provide good career information, et cetera, because to put someone along a pathway for which they're ill-suited is to no one's benefit.
Yeah, educate the public about this untapped job market. They're not thinking about this industry because it's not a place maybe they frequent a lot. You go into a retail store.
Sure.
You go to the mechanic, but you don't necessarily go into a logistics organization.
Right.
Yeah. So educate them, and so that they actually have the interest to want to pursue that. If the interest is there, the motivation's there, they'll follow up, they're more likely to get hired.
Okay. A little different spin on accessibility, but I appreciate the comments very much. How about right here? Just pass the mic. Hi.
Hi, my name is Tammy. I'm with ETR. I'm just curious about, because that sounds like it's such a great program, but could we put them into some type of work experience program in those logistics just to see if this is something that they are going to want to pursue?
So one of the things that's been suggested throughout, I would say, every forum that we've done, both here and in other regions, is that one of the ways to make education and training programs much more accessible, much more successful, is this opportunity to let people try jobs. And there's a variety of tools kind of in our toolkit for doing it. You have internships, work experience, at the high school level, sometimes and earlier, you have opportunities for job shadowing, you know, career days, a variety. What do you think works?
Well, I mean, I think that maybe the high school program might be a good idea. I mean, something even, you know, the ROC program does, I mean, I know they have various, they have banking, I'm not sure what all the, but I know for years they've had banking and, I think that that would be a good opportunity maybe to work with some employees in logistics or maybe welding, you
To give people exposure, is that what you're saying?
Have exposure so they can see what the everyday, you know, what it looks like with the, you know, you go into welding and you...
Right.
You know, maybe your vision is not going to be suitable for that type of work.
We have got like another 2 minutes. You were raising your hand.
Yes, I think that there's one segment that we haven't spoken of in regards to individuals with barriers to employment, and those are individuals with disabilities.
Yeah, we haven't talked about that at all. I was waiting for the group to bring it up. Okay, so the hallmark of a good meeting, I learned many, many years ago, is one that ends on time. So I had a comment here and a comment here. You guys okay? Comment in the back. Let's go. So 1 minute, and then we're gonna go 1 minute in the back. Right here. So.
No, I just was gonna say, anybody here, employers, we're talking about all these things about what we're gonna do, but if you're an employer, you want people that can work and will be able to work, disability or no, it's just, you know, they have to be able to do the job and they can, accommodations may be made, whatever, but the real problem is making sure that was ever coming out of high school or whatever, you got somebody that can come to work and be trainable and know how to do or how to do the job. So employers, you know, none of these talking about what the employers want, they're talking about what we think we want. But if you don't ask the employers and you don't talk to them, you're never gonna solve your problem.
Right. So most of these forums are absolutely employer-centric. They're absolutely demand-driven. This particular one, we're talking about training, so it does raise the question.
I understand, but the board's got a lot of money on training.
Absolutely, and no one is suggesting that a resource be delivered as a candidate who is ill-prepared for work. The question is, how do we take people who are ill-prepared for work and get them really prepared for work so that when they present themselves for a job, that disability or whatever the barrier...
My suggestion is, you talk about youth, they're in high school, so you have a captive audience, or you might as well try there and start from that aspect.
It's an excellent recommendation.
That's your first start right there. If you can't do it there, then you're never going to do it.
Okay, very good. So we have time for one more comment right here.
And I appreciate him speaking about employers. Mm-hmm. That's kind of what I'm going to bring into all this. You know, all of the training and all the training dollars, you know, you can spend as much money as the budget will allow, but if there is not a job for that individual at the end, all of that training is useless and worth nothing.
Right.
And in fact, the AJC and the unions have put together certain things for individuals to go into the transportation or infrastructure. The training took place a year and a half, 2 years ago, and those infrastructure jobs are just now starting to hit.
Right.
The training for that module was 2 years ahead of time. And the candidates that went through the program, whether or not they finished successfully or not, the ones that did, there was no job for them to go to. So it's just like a welder John trains. If there's no welding jobs for those individuals to go into, that training is just like sending somebody to incarceration because you just wasted their time for nothing. And that's the main thing. And in the construction industry, every day a tradesman goes to work,
right,
that's one day closer he or she is on the unemployment line.
Right. So we started out by saying, just to introduce, you know, what we were going to be talking about today, is that California is shifting its attention, shifting its efforts, shifting its strategies and its focus and its resources on developing a demand-driven system. Remember, we said that early on. So it has to be driven by business. And that's why we have the question about training for skills in demand jobs in key sectors. That's all business determined. We cannot here in this room say, what are the demand jobs? What are the key sectors? Those present themselves. And they reveal themselves to us by virtue of data and employer input, et cetera. So we have about 1 minute left. So we have time for one more comment if anyone has one. Let's go to this gentleman on the end.
I just want to go back to what you were asking earlier about the individuals with
disabilities. Yeah.
I think it really comes down to those individuals understanding the fact that there are resources. You know, as a community, they know there's resources to assist them in jobs. But in terms of those disabled individuals or just individuals with barriers as a whole, they don't know that there's places out here that are willing to assist them in career exploration. They don't understand that there's also training that is worth your time, and again, training that's not worth your time. These individuals have been left to just get to adulthood and then be struggling to face that working world. They didn't have a first-time job, they didn't have training, they didn't have individuals saying education is the way to go. So I think reminding ourselves that there's individuals out there that need just, hey, we have information, I don't know if you have this information, so we need to present that information to these individuals.
Sure.
So making them aware of all the information that we take advantage of on a daily basis.
Right. So in summary, I'd say here's what we've talked about over the last hour and a half or so. We've talked about the fact that there are lots and lots of training resources available in Kern County and adjacent counties, et cetera. And they prepare individuals for work in a variety of ways. They prepare them in terms of literacy and numeracy so they can read and write. And they give them soft skills so that they have the skills in the workplace. We have a number of programs that prepare people in a variety, from hospitality to manufacturing to transportation to information and communications technology. Some programs are better than others. In order to make sure that everyone, from the very ready for work to the not so ready for work, have the opportunity to become a candidate, a resource for jobs in the community, we need to be able to marshal resources in the right way. So I very, very much appreciate your comments. I know some of you have additional comments, but I did promise to get you out on time. I'm gonna stick around and I will take in your information. So thank you very much for the generosity of the information you shared. Thank you for showing up. I appreciate it very much. Thanks.